right. Thank you, everybody. We're letting folks join the live stream now. Thank you for joining us today. Gordon and myself will be talking about the state of influencer marketing, the sort of global state of influencer marketing in 2023. We're going to get kicked off a couple of minutes past 2 Eastern to let more folks join. So just sit tight for a couple minutes, grab coffee if you're on the West, maybe tea if you're, in Europe, if it's a little bit later where Gordon is, but we'll get started at about 2 or 3 minutes past and we'll dive into the slides today. Thank you again, everybody, for joining us. Start with some music. Just once again, as folks are continuing to join us for our live stream today, we'll be getting started a couple minutes past the hour. We'll be diving into the state of influencer marketing in 2023. I have my guest host, Gordon Glenister, with me as well. And we've got a lot of really, really interesting data and insights that we're pulling together. We'll have some great Q&A and just tee up some trends for the new year. But just sit tight while we have more folks joining the live stream. Again, we'll get started just a couple of minutes past the hour, so maybe 1 or 2 minutes from now. Right. I want to thank everybody again for joining myself and my guest host, Gordon, today. We'll continue to let people join in, but you're tuned into the State of Influencer Marketing 2023, presented by HypeAuditor. So your hosts today are myself. I'm Ryan Hilliard, the GM of North America here at HypeAuditor. And then I want to introduce my guest host. He's a author of a tremendous book, Influencer Marketing Strategy, as well as an influencer marketing consultant, speaker, and podcaster. We've got Gordon Glenister actually joining us from the other side of the world for me. How are you doing today, Gordon?
Good to see you, Ryan. Yes, very nice. Thank you.
Awesome. So just a couple of housekeeping things as we get into today's agenda for folks. Feel free to drop any questions that you have directly in the chat. We're going to be earmarking maybe the final 10 or 15 minutes of today's presentation, just going through those questions. We're going to try to hold off on answering any of them as we go, just so that we can get through all of the content. We have a lot of information here. We have some tremendous global statistics. We dive into the big three networks and changes that are happening there with ages, demographics, and different patterns and behaviors, product improvements that they're making for brands. And then we've compiled 6 really, really valuable actionable trends for 2023 to keep an eye on Things that if you can invest earlier, there's definitely some arbitrage opportunities where you can be a quick mover and see some really, really tremendous benefits from that movement. And then finally, we'll have our open Q&A. So again, please feel free to ask your questions as you go so that you don't forget. We will go in order at the end and jump into the Q&A. The purpose of this really is to try to provide marketers, whether you're on the brand side or you're on the agency side or you're new to influencer marketing, maybe you're a creator yourself, perspective on what's happening in the influencer marketing, creative marketing space. What changes are happening, what trends are occurring, what's going on with the audience, just so that you can be more and more informed around how you treat this when it comes to alignment with your business goals. And I think, as everybody knows, in 2023, budgets might be a little bit more tighter with changing economic conditions. And so doing more with less is critical. And so these takeaways will directly impact the results that you see. And so it's really, really important to keep them in mind. So real quick, we like to highlight where all of this data comes from. So we spent the last several months compiling tens of millions of data points from different third parties, from our own database, publicly available data, to try to paint a picture of what's actually happening in this space. We try to put it alongside information that comes out from the networks themselves, from articles. And so tens of millions of data points and hundreds of hours were put into compiling this information, trying to make sense of it for you, the advertiser, or you, the brand, or you, the agency representing that brand. And so all of this data, again, is publicly accessible and tremendously valuable. And I think goes a long way in providing perspective as to what's happening. So great, let's get started. I think, Gordon, maybe I've done enough of a monologue to start. I'll hand it over to you. Our first slide is really just talking about this is a global state of influencer marketing, and I know that we have over 60 countries that registered across 800 registrants for this webinar, and we'll have people joining later, we'll have people watching the live stream after the fact because they've got meetings now. But what are your thoughts as you begin to think about the top geographies in terms of brands that are getting mentions from influencers, the number of creators, where they're coming from, just when you look at this slide yourself?
Yeah, I mean, what's really interesting, I'm not surprised to see the growth of the United States in there, but particularly of interest is Brazil. I had the benefit of going to Brazil last year, and my goodness, they absolutely love their influencers. if you've got if some of the content creators that have got a million subscribers on YouTube are almost considered small. So I think it's just part of this mobile first. Some of these emerging countries, they live and breathe on WhatsApp. And also the younger audiences in these countries, they're the ones that are showing significant growth as well. I mean, Indonesia, for example, look, big numbers coming from that. So I think we realize more than ever that influencer marketing is very much a global discipline. We knew that already, but even more so, the fact that we've got over 50 countries or so represented on this webinar suggests that. So what I would say to brands, don't just put your marketing dollars in one country. Really think about, spreading the load.
Yeah, I think that your point around emerging markets in terms of just being more mobile first and just understanding, hey, I can get whatever I want accomplished on my phone. I don't have to shift to desktop. And that just is very conducive to how creators operate, how social networks operate, what they're designed for. If you even think about Instagram's desktop experience is basically just a mobile experience that they slap on a big screen. Whereas, like I'm sort of guilty of it myself in the US, big purchases, I still tend to shift to a larger screen, a larger device, just because I've just always done that. But in other countries, it's just they're just so used to using their phones for everything that you could see really, really high direct response rates, really, really high engagement and conversions and sales from those countries because people are just used to that behavior, which I think is really, really interesting.
Well, just one question I was going to ask just before we move on. Did your methodology include China? Because I was surprised to see China not mentioned there.
You know, that's a great question. I'm actually not sure. I'd have to check back with our analytics team on how they were compiling data, what data points that they were looking at. But yes, that is a sort of elephant in the room that's missing here, that I think it'd be worthwhile to try to dig a little bit deeper and understand, where do they fall in this mix, or are we able to pull in that data? Because sometimes there's also just that issue with, getting access to that data and what publicly accessible data is available.
Course.
And actually, I have someone chiming in from our data team saying this is the Instagram picture in terms of geography. So that makes a lot of sense as well. Cool. So now we're going to dive into networks. We have our focus mostly on the big three networks. We have Instagram, we have TikTok, and we have YouTube. So we're going to start with Instagram. And I think the title of this slide sort of says it all, that it's just sort of a table stakes choice network. It's reliable. You know what to expect from it. And so while it might not be perhaps as sexy as something like TikTok, almost all marketers are like, yes, we will for sure do something on Instagram. And I think even your experience, Gordon, sort of speaks to that around people's focus on using Instagram as the platform.
No, absolutely. No, I mean, I was just going to say that a lot of influencers have been around Instagram for a while, so they've already got an established audience. So in a way, there's no surprise to see that it is still such a at the forefront of this. Although obviously TikTok is very keen to be the competing platform, if you will, but it still drives a lot of engagement. It allows content creation very simply, and we're going to see some of the new things that are coming in on the platform, which is going to make it even easier for creators and brands to connect even further with the platform.
Yeah, I think, I mean, we'll talk about that in a little bit, but I think recognizing that a company like Meta, they don't stop the investment in their tools, and they're trying to make it easier and easier for brands and agencies representing brands to drive direct response, which they know ultimately is what drives that investment for you all into to choosing influencer marketing as a channel where you're gonna put your money. And so they're gonna continue to innovate there. To show, hey, this is a safe place to go. And maybe some of the formats are a little bit easier to get started with and whatnot. But I think that bold 87% of users take action when they see sponsored posts is really, really insightful. It's
Indeed.
why people continue to come back to this. So we will get into TikTok and sort of as a sneak preview. Anytime I talk to a customer or a prospect, TikTok is where they want to be. That is their priority thinking about the year. But I think it comes at the assumption that Instagram is going to be there and it's going to provide value.
And also, Ryan, it's a safe place to be, isn't it? People that have been there feel comfortable with that. And when they're trying to promote this internally with the finance team, they need to show that it's been a proven success already, and that's definitely what happens with Instagram.
Yeah, and I think that even if we think about the breakdowns of age specifically, not so much gender for this, but as we think about age, that's probably one of the reasons why, right? So we know Instagram skews a little bit older. It's getting older, right? It's sort of Facebook did this exact same thing 10 years ago where the audience continues to use it and they get older and new networks arise, Snapchat, TikTok, whatever it may be. But the one value to your audience getting a little bit older but still using that platform is their discretionary income typically goes up as they progress further in their careers. Their buying power goes up. I remember in my career prior to joining on the software side or the brand side of things, I worked at an agency and we saw the same type of thing with Bing ads versus Google ads, where you couldn't spend enough money on Bing ads because no one's really using it, but it converted so well because it was people like my parents or maybe younger than that, they just used it because it came with their desktop and it was really simple to drive sales because they had the income. You didn't have to worry as much about, okay, I have to find somebody with money to purchase this product that I'm also selling. It was just a little bit easier. And so I think that's definitely something that we see play out with Instagram in terms of that audience getting a little bit older. Also, just the number of males, I think we were talking about this prior to the call, Gordon, but just more and more males are joining Instagram. And we see the same thing. We'll get to TikTok in a little bit. And so it's beginning to skew much more evenly than maybe it was 5 or so years ago.
100% as more and more people. Although I can say that my category is very poorly represented at 0.16%.
Oh, I had you pegged in that 35 to 44, Gordon.
Well,
okay.
Sadly not.
Okay. And no, people, we did not rehearse that. That was just on the fly. That was good. All right. So size. Now, if we think about creators, this is, I think, really, really valuable for brands that are just getting into influencer marketing, but maybe also a reminder for those people with established programs. Because when you have an established program, you tend to think bigger and bigger and bigger. But in terms of where the creators can be found, it's definitely on that smaller scale. It's no secret as to why, right? It's easier to get 1,000 followers and 10,000 followers than it is 50 or 100. You have the amount of engagement that you have to be able to grow that organically is really, really hard. So there's always going to be more people on the smaller side, but then they also make up for it, right? And that engagement rate, there seems to be a lot of value there. I don't know if you had any thoughts or commentary there, Gordon.
Very relatable to their audience. If you think about somebody that has got, like 100 comments, they're more likely to be able to respond to them and have a conversation with their audience than somebody that has got, 3,000 comments. That is not going to be the case. I always suggest that when somebody's running a campaign, perhaps for the first time, they may start with a group of nano influencers that have got different audiences. It's a bit like, betting on a horse race. You know, if you've literally just gone with one influencer and for some reason or another, it doesn't work, it's very difficult to convince individuals within the company to either spend more or do it again. Whereas actually, if you're working with a number of influencers, particularly at this size, you can get some really spectacular results, which will then allow you to scale up and increase your campaign success rate. But yeah, I mean, we've seen some fantastic engagement rates of double digit into 20% plus in some cases, which is great.
Yeah, I think one thing that you said there too around, if you've got $20,000 or $40,000 you're going to invest in influencer marketing for the whole year, right? You're going to steal some of your paid ads budget, some of your paid social budget. And you want to go into influencer marketing, sure, you could go crazy. You could say, I'm going to spend 40 or 50K on one person, and that's super risky. But maybe on the flip side of that risk is if you only have a little bit of budget, if you only choose one nano influencer, it could be successful, but it's very likely to be something you won't even notice in terms of the contribution to the whole. And so as you're winning stakeholders, winning people in the company, like, hey, yes, we should continue to do this. It's totally worth the time, right? It might not be a money thing. In this case, it might just be more of a time and effort thing. You want to pick a few just so that you can say, hey, look, here's a noticeable bump in sales, right? If you have a nano influencer with 1,200 followers that crushes it, your company might not notice those 15 orders though, right? Like that's the other risk, is you have to win people over. Like this is something that can actually contribute to our overall growth. And so picking up half a dozen of them to really, really test out different things, learn different things, I think is really, really important.
Yeah. And just to add to that, there are some very good examples of photographers and videographers that actually have relatively small audiences, but amazing content. Yeah. And that's where you could actually work with them and put some paid media spend to boost that content. And you could actually find you get greater results overall in terms of conversions because the content really does deliver.
Awesome. We're getting lots of questions, but it looks like my colleague Nick is helping answer them. I'll make sure that he flags me on Slack or something separately if I need to come back to one. Again, continue to put your questions in the comment bar. We're going to do a Q&A open at the end, but as it's pertinent to the specific slides, I'm sure some of my colleagues will jump in and start answering them as well, just to make sure that we address them and don't get confused as to what slide we're talking about. Cool. So now we're going to talk about notable product updates, and we're going to do the same format as we think about the other networks as well. So keep that in mind. A few huge updates, right? Product tags are available for all US users now. There's more effort being put into the creator side of thing, making it easier for brands to find them and for them to find brands. Like the takeaway that I had, Gordon, I don't want to steal your thunder. I'll let you jump in as well. But Instagram knows the easier we can make this for a direct selling experience, it's easy to get through the cart to make that purchase ultimately, the better it is for advertisers and then the better it is for them ultimately. People will invest more because if it's driving sales reliably and there's attribution there, people will continue to invest there. And so I think we're going to continue to see this from Meta across all of their platforms by adding more and more things that make it conducive to that purchase and then, trying to bring that analytics to the forefront as well.
Yeah, 100%. I just want to add to the second point there, which was media kits, because I think I still find great influencers and content creators they lack on monetizing more of their content because they don't really know and understand what brands really want, which is performance, which is all those important metrics. So anything that helps these content creators talk the language of the marketeer, the better. And as you rightly say, it's almost like influencers are becoming the new retailers if they're not already in many instances. So, like product tags as well, it's just making the whole shopping experience quicker, faster, and more efficient. I mean, if you think about shopping, you go into, as us guys, we go into a retail store, we see something maybe on a mannequin, we say, oh, we like that, but that's about it. One of the great benefits about influencer marketing is you've got somebody that really is selling the benefits of the various products and demonstrating in a way that a retail shop just cannot do. Plus, if you're following your specific niche influencer content creator, they're totally honed into your style as well. So the likely shoppability of shirts, shoes, trousers, the whole works is far greater.
That the context that you can provide in a short 30-second video, it's one of the reasons why like a companies like Cuts are $100 million direct-to-consumer brands now, because they're just able your people are able to visualize it, put it in perspective, understand
Correct.
what it looks like in the real world. It's not just a white background, right? And sometimes that is really useful for those product pages, but when you're trying to show the product and the value of it, it's that context that's way more valuable, and ultimately drives more people to purchase. And so I think we're just going to continue to see more of that. How can we make this conducive? I think that last one, and I know TikTok's doing something similar, but finding ways for creators who want to flock to these platforms as well, and revenue sharing and whatnot. I know YouTube did a fair bit of that with Shorts as well, trying to motivate creators to do that. It's going to be a new influx, which is actually good for the brands, right? It will get a little bit more competitive, maybe a little bit more of a bloody ocean if you've read that book. But the one value is if there's more creators in the space, you're probably going to find prices can even come down a little bit. And so then it's really on you to find those creators that really resonate with what you're trying to offer. Who is the person that we want to talk to? Do we really know our user and how we can drive them to purchase? Then it really puts it back into your hands. As the marketer, which I think is awesome. And being a digital marketer myself for more than a dozen years and working in direct response advertising, like that's something that I just love the idea. Like, oh yes, it's just like almost keywords were for Google search. Like I just have so much more control now and there's just so many options. Cool. So now we're going to jump into TikTok. And I think it's pretty obvious to say this is probably not breaking news at all, but TikTok is the home of entertainment these days. 1 billion monthly active users. There's all sorts of challenges that it faces in terms of rival platforms creating similar products, regulatory concerns that you read about in the news all the time. It doesn't sort of change the fact that people are flocking to the app, using the app all the time, and brands are also joining. And so that's just, I think, if you've not thought about TikTok, if you've thought, oh, we're just not really that into doing that sort of format, you're really going to miss the boat because this is where everything is really surging.
I agree.
I think maybe a bad tee up there. What I think one thing, Gordon, that was really interesting that our team put together and an insight that they had is the distinction between how people tend to use Instagram, where they're following friends and creators, but a lot of friends, like that carryover of Facebook days or MySpace days, or people will probably remember Zynga and Friendster, all of that stuff, right? Where it's just, it's all about that network. TikTok is more about engaging with popular trends, like people you don't know, you just want to engage with, which I would actually argue is almost more similar to YouTube in terms of a competitor than it is even Instagram.
And do you know, and do you know, the word I would use about TikTok, which I hear all of the time, is it's addictive. And I don't hear that amongst the other channels, but I do hear it about TikTok. So, you know, the way the algorithm creates the type of content, because it's entertainment driven, I think it plays to our emotion. It makes us laugh. It makes us cry. It makes us sad. It makes us all those types of things. So therefore, it's very easy to lose 2 or 3 hours just scrolling TikTok, isn't it? I mean, even myself, I've found, you know, I can't believe I've been on this for so long. But it's the nature of the beast, really.
Yeah, definitely. So here's where we see a huge distinction between the networks. The age skewing and then even gender towards female and young, right? 13 to 17, 18 to 24, very, very young audience. And through the years, there's always been talks around like, how can we even make this safe for young audiences so that we continue to grow those young audiences? And I talked about a little bit around that buying power, that discretionary income that maybe is less so with those folks, but what you can do on TikTok is you can invest early as a brand in users, right? Get them really interested in what you do and how you present yourself as a brand so that they sort of grow with you, right? You get that added benefit of, you know, if I can really resonate with them and keep them around and engage for a couple of years, like this could be really, really tremendous from a business value perspective, but maybe it's not as immediate. Maybe it's more of a branding exercise. Now, I don't know, Gordon, have you seen it? How have you seen it successfully used both as a branding or a direct response vehicle?
Well, what's really interesting is even during the pandemic, you know, the UK government used TikTok and influencers to, you know, get us all to wash our hands properly, because they realized that actually these young people in particular were not watching TV, were not, you know, and had somewhat of a anti-establishment view about things. Oh, well, it's not happening to me. And so they really had this challenge at how are they going to, you know, put some importance and value to this. So that's what they did. It's been really interesting. So you've got brands like Red Bull and Gymshark that are really all over these platforms now, and have done hugely well. And I think, I mean, what would be really interesting to know is whether or not there's been a transition from Snapchat over here at all, or whether or not that Snapchat audience has been fairly stable. And they are slightly different, because obviously they cater for a very young audience largely, don't they?
Yeah, definitely. So similar story when we think about creators. Again, it's just easier to be a nano influencer. There's a huge percentage of them. And then in terms of the growth of sizes, like it's pretty stable in terms of the amount of engagement rates over time. Smaller creators tend to drive the highest engagement rates. I think you talking about the algorithm before, Gordon, even lends itself to smaller creators have an opportunity to become bigger creators almost more easily on this platform. And so if you think about yourself as a brand, if you find a creator that really does resonate, you could benefit from, okay, if this really clicks well, this might pay dividends, you know, into the future. Because they're going to be a bigger follower. Now, counting on that stuff, predicting that stuff is really, really tricky. I would say probably not really feasible, but there is that potential value there.
Yeah, and you can go on live now with just 1,000 followers, which with the right level of niche audience and consistent content creation, isn't that difficult to do. So again, what we are seeing with TikTok is everyday people suddenly becoming TikTok stars overnight almost.
Yeah. And so then as a brand, maybe this is a shameless plug, but finding those tools that help you understand who's the makeup of the audience within from this influencer, right? It seems like they should be relevant. What are their ages and demographics specifically, right? Tools that, like HypeAuditor that make that really, really simple to find that alignment become really, really valuable in streamlining that whole process and taking a lot of the guessing out of it. For TikTok and YouTube, we have a couple of different sites that weren't on Instagram, but I think one of the most interesting things here is how fluid it is with the most engaging brands. It tells you how early TikTok still is. And if you feel like, well, we've been talking about TikTok for 2 years, I'm too late, you're definitely not, right? Seven out of the top 10 brands in terms of mentions and eight out of the top 10 fastest growing creators are completely new to this list, right? So there's a lot of movement happening. It's not established, it's not at this sort of stagnant place. There's lots of opportunities. And if you look at even the brand names, yeah, there's some very, very notable brand names out there, but there's plenty of brand names that aren't your sort of Fortune 100 e-commerce giant, right? Or Fortune 1000 e-commerce giant. There's lots of other ones out there. And then I think from the creator side of things, seeing somebody like Mr. Beast, which I'm located in North Carolina. He's actually in Greenville, not too far from where I am in Raleigh. But him finding, okay, I'm going to have both of these channels going. I'm not just going to be on YouTube where he's the top. I'm also going to be over here and seeing creators begin to move between places and not just have a single network.
Do you know what's really interesting is the consistency of their growth. And, I mean, when you talk about engagement rates, normally those big audiences have much, much lower engagement rates of like 0.1%, 2%, 3%, well, actually more like 1% and 2%, to be honest. But to see things like 15.87 for Brad Bunny and Mr. Beast right up there at 11.57, it's truly remarkable, which again shows the consistency of the content and the fact that these creators or channels really, really do understand their channel. And that's why, when it comes to influencer marketing, it's not always about the size of the following. It really is about the engagement rate and the quality of that quality and the relevance of that audience. And that, again, just plugging you guys, is so important for when you're running an influencer campaign, not to just look at the influencer yourself, but actually be very mindful of the relevance of that follower count and the interests in the particular core subject area.
Yeah, that engagement rate too, when a creator knows how to maintain it, they're usually a safer investment for you as a brand in terms of what you can get expectations wise. You might find, right, some of these partnerships at the high end, you're not going to drive the direct response that you need to make it make financial sense. It's going to be a bit of a branding exercise as well, but you can feel a little bit safer as you're finding even smaller influencers that are producing regular content, driving a similar level of engagement. It's a little bit safer than people that shy away. If there's creators that shy away from sharing statistics or have reasons for statistics, those could be red flags. And so it's really you want to look at those creators that are regularly producing, regularly understanding how can I actively engage with my audience in a very authentic way. Similar story here to Instagram when it comes to product updates, more and more around how can we make it easier for people to purchase. How can we shift this to direct response mode? Because that's ultimately what gets the smaller advertisers playing in the game. And while sure, really, really large advertisers will sink a lot of budget into these things and see a lot of results from it, similar to how it was when I was working at an agency, Google counts on those smaller businesses because there's 100 to 1 of those. And if we can get them all participating and seeing value there, it helps them ultimately. So greater investment from TikTok into more direct response initiatives. How can we measure these sales? How can we provide value to these retailers so that they'll continue to come back? I think I remember when we don't have Twitter on here, but when Elon Musk took over Twitter, one of the things that was a huge urgent thing was we are not a direct response channel. Advertisers don't use us for that. And that's a huge disadvantage, especially in sort of economic uncertain times where people are tightening budgets a little bit. You need to cater to direct response because everybody loves doing branding. Everybody loves the Super Bowl is coming up in the US. People are going to spend like $6 million for 30 seconds. They all love that when the times are great, but when they have to be a little bit tighter, they really want to think about, well, how could I ultimately drive a sale here? And I think it's what we're seeing from TikTok. We already see it from YouTube. We see it from Instagram, and I think we'll continue to see it as new networks show up as well.
Yeah, and also just that first point, 730% increase in video descriptions. You know, we're now in the attention economy. If people weren't already aware of that, you know, being able to capture the attention of people as they scroll through is more becoming more and more urgent. So if your video caption isn't engaging enough, then you're not even get, even if the video is amazing. If you haven't captured it in that thumbnail or description, you know, you're not going to actually see your video being shown. So I think that's a really interesting development.
All right, so now on to YouTube. When we were putting together these slides, it felt just appropriate to give this stat its own sort of space because YouTube is old at this point, right? I remember when I started my agency, we were still talking about YouTube being like the second most used search engine in the world, and it's still, I think, number three. People use it all the time, and Google is learning and adapting to the market and understanding, okay, people like shorter content. Let's produce shorter content to get them over to our app. And then we can still have this longer format of video as well that drives direct response, it drives all of this value, right? I learned things about addressing a car concern, fixing something in the yard, right? YouTube is tremendously valuable and the numbers aren't shrinking, right? 2.9 billion monthly logged in users. I'm
Incredible
an
on that, really.
Android, yeah, I'm an Android user too. So like that ecosystem is humongous as well. And so that's just more and more folks that get it tossed into their feed all the time. And so it's just going to continue to grow. It's not shrinking at all. And so I just think it's a huge, maybe underappreciated statistic. And I think maybe it's awesome that we're doing this live stream on YouTube because it makes it look like it was all planned.
Even my 86-year-old mum watches YouTube on a daily basis, you know, which is incredible, really, isn't it?
So I alluded to this before. We probably could go on for hours on all of the things, the advice that we've, or maybe the advice we shouldn't have taken from YouTube. But I think the interesting statistic is that users and subscribers themselves report that they follow advice and recommendations from the people that they're following. And I think the big thing that's different about YouTube versus TikTok, and I would say that they're much more competitive in terms of format than maybe something like Instagram, is this long form of content that people go and they plan to digest, right? If all of a sudden TikTok was dropping 30-minute videos into your feed, right? Like that would be a whole different experience. But that's what you're used to on YouTube. And so you can go and you can trust and you can rely on this and you can look at things historically. And so that format just lends itself really, really well to direct response. A lot of that educational marketing where you're trying to teach and show people ultimately methods or approaches, right? Almost what we're doing here is really, really great for YouTube and great for brands that do that.
I mean, some of the beauty tutorials you've got people running 45-minute tutorials, and they've got those audiences engaged for that amount of time. I mean, that is phenomenal for a brand to be connected with a content creator that's got an engaged audience for that amount of time. Of
Yeah, and the creators can see it, right? The analytics is there.
course.
Maybe a little bit less interesting on the breakdown of age and demographics. It's been very, very stable year over year over year, and that's because it's, you know, more than a decade old of an audience. In terms of growth, in terms of largest channels, right? The largest ones are still the largest ones. The huge growth that we're seeing from folks like Mr. Beast or T-Series, just adding tens of millions of subscribers every year, because it still does produce as a channel. But then they're also expanding into other channels. And I think if you're an advertiser or you're a marketer, thinking about, okay, I'm going to invest with a creator, can I get them to put this content on all of the networks that they're engaged with is where you can really maximize the ROI. It might be a little bit more expensive, but I think that all of these networks are lending themselves to be that way because the creators are beginning to spread out and be in multiple places.
What's interesting here is to see that children's entertainment content is doing so well, and yet we've looked at the other channels having a younger audiences than maybe YouTube has. So that's an interesting observation.
YouTube is beginning to adopt handles like everybody else. More shoppable links for more creators, monetization. So more creators coming this way, and then Shopify. That integration is everywhere, right? We have our own Shopify integration. Being able to see as a brand what's happening, they know it's really, really important. Google knows this really, really well with their Google Ads program or AdWords at the time, and so they understand. And this is a great place for you as a brand to invest your money and see those results. If you could tell, I'm picking up speed a little bit, Gordon. I want to jump into some of the trends that we see, and then we'll have plenty of time, I think, for Q&A at the end. So we identified six trends, and so we're going to talk through those. And the cool thing I think about them, as we were talking about this before, Gordon, is how actionable and useful these things are today, right? You can use this and go, how could I apply this, and actually go apply it, right? And it's not just some theory that's played out and maybe in 3 years, we'll reflect back on it and find that we were wrong. But these are actually things that are happening right now. Right. So the first one, and I think you've alluded to it in terms of investing with nano influencers, the size of the investment can vary from, product giveaway to an influencer to maybe hundreds of dollars to even millions of dollars. But influencer marketing can reach anybody. Any brand can really actually do it effectively. We have restaurant customers, we have big giant agencies, we have big giant e-commerce brands, right? Anybody can really use it. It's just more about knowing your audience, but you can find creators that will fit just about any budget, which I think is just
100%.
tremendous.
I mean, what I find interesting as well, you've got a lot of startup brands that don't have huge amounts of marketing budget actually using influencers as part of their strategy, because they're actually helping them grow audiences as well. They want, when you're starting a brand from scratch, you don't have an audience. So actually, if ever there was a time to use influencer marketing, it is at the smaller end as well as anything else. So, and as we go into what is going to be a bit of a challenging year, they often say the best time to spend money is in a recession because of it's when your competitors are retrenching and saving money left, right, and center. Is making sure that but use it in the right way and use it with the right and relevant influencers. That's my only caveat to that. You can waste money with influencer marketing if you don't have a proper strategy, you don't use the right influencers, and you've not got the right campaign.
Yeah, I can definitely attest to working off of assumptions in a previous role, and thinking, well, this worked the first time, let's just do it again with similar people without diving into too much depth and wasting tens of thousands of dollars. But if you find that alignment, right, like what you said, built brands building off of this, it's because they find truly authentic alignment with a creator. And the creator has got an authentic audience as well. So being able to make sure that it's a real quality audience is really important. But when you do, it's natural, right? That promotion is very, very natural. And they want to keep on pushing it because it represents them as a, like their personal brand as a creator well. Gordon, you were talking about this. I'll let you just sort of jump off this slide from the beginning, but just the impact of gaming influencers.
It's a monster, isn't it? I mean, look at that, 184 billion in 2022. What is also fascinating here is that gamers aren't necessarily just great brand opportunities for entertainment and gaming brands, but much wider than that now. So fashion brands are interested in gamers. All sorts of different types of cosmetics brands. So it's a re because they have a great engaged audience. They really are very gamers, and their audience are very, very loyal to their fan base. So it's really fascinating to see the growth in this sector.
Yeah, the thought that just popped into my head was like energy drinks were really early. It's almost like whatever an energy drink is doing now, like that's probably the future investment that everybody else will be doing in a couple of years because they're very early on in finding engagements with Twitch and people that were on Twitch and those gamers themselves. So yes, lots of exposure to brands that are not necessarily gaming brands, but is that person's audience aligned with you? Because ultimately you're selling to that audience, whether they're on Instagram, They're watching somebody stream, or they're on watching TV on a commercial pops up, right? It's all about just finding the person that you want to buy, not I need them to be searching for this exact keyword. That's
Right.
the thing that's the secret here.
There's also, Ryan, an honesty about gamers. You know, there is an authenticity, I think, about they've got their own almost bullshitometer. They won't promote brands that they don't feel is going to align with their audiences. And that's the same with all influencer marketing. But to be honest, I think it's particularly true when it comes to gaming influencers.
Yeah, so that means if you're thinking, I'll just reach out to this gamer, there's a chance that they might just say no to you as well, which I think is good.
Indeed.
TikTok and Instagram growth is just huge. And I think everybody knows this, but I think it's just going to continue, right? As people continue to lean into channels where how can we make the most of our marketing dollars? How can we drive more engagement with our audience? I think we'll see more and more brands investing into this area, trying to get more out of it. But just the users and their ability to attract users is just continuing to grow. Is there probably some network lurking in the shadows somewhere? Probably, right? And that will be here in the next 5 years. But right now, no signs that these folks are going away. Audiences continue to grow and grow and grow. And I think that's just great for brands and for agencies representing brands, as these networks make it easier to find creators or tools like ours, find creators, engage with them. Track those sales, make sure that you're understanding what's going on. How can you drive the most results?
TikTok sponsoring loads of things as well. I mean, the TikTok brand is in so many big sporting events as well, which is quite interesting. I don't know if you've picked that up.
All right. Well, I'm sure that there are many welcome to Wrexham fans. We're big Wrexham AFC fans over here. The Ryan Reynolds, Rob McElhenney football club is based out of Wales. They're the title sponsor of their jersey. And I think that they're
Okay.
in the National League, right? League five or something like that.
And I'm
So,
sure I've seen TikTok sponsor cricket and all sorts of things that you'd think, really? But yeah, it's.
live shopping again, really, really important. It's a great way to show, especially like in fashion, other industries that are just conducive to visuals, right? How do you engage with the product in person? This becomes more and more important, so that people just go to these retailers and just buy directly. They're not looking for that education there. They're consuming that education online, and I think we'll continue to see that not just on TikTok, but Instagram and YouTube and all of these other networks as well.
Well, Amazon realized that back in 2020, where they put out a requirement to hire 100,000 influencers for their platform, realizing that live streaming was going to be huge, and it continues to be so, and I think it's going to be even greater this coming year.
Yeah, I love their sort of QVC format of
Yeah.
Prime Day. You go on there and there's people talking like they're a home shopping network. It's always fun to watch. More videos, but shorter in length. I think the bigger takeaway here is that if you love the type of content on a specific network and you're like, this is why I'm all in on TikTok or Instagram, just give it 6 months. The several hundred engineers, the other brands or platforms have in terms of bandwidth, are going to build the same product, right? They're going to find a similar way to do it, leverage their strengths, right? They're going to find ways to use their indexing power to position these shorts to people on our YouTube, putting them on people's phones, right? If you're just going through your Google News feed, right? But it's going to be adaptable everywhere. There's going to be more and more similarities. And I think then it's just the difference of who is the audience of this creator and what kind of content are they absorbing there? I talked about it before. TikTok and YouTube are very, very similar in terms of like it's spotting trends, not necessarily engaging with people that you're friends with. And so those sort of comparable things might mean, hey, can we work with you to post this content both on TikTok and on YouTube, right? Can we do a short and can we do a TikTok over here so that we can broaden our reach, increase our effectiveness. You creator don't necessarily have to create more videos or more content, but we get the benefit of it being in more places, right? Where our audience is. And then this is I believe, the last takeaway that we have. And this is like the one that I would underline. I've said it at a conference that was here in Raleigh before, and I know I brought it up on a recent webinar. But B2B companies are always doing this. It was with this with social, with paid social, where they go, this influencer marketing isn't for us. We're B2B. We sell, you know, very, very expensive software subscriptions, or we sell very, very big industrial products. But in a couple of years, they begin to realize, you know, it's the same person though. And then they come in and they dominate the space. And I don't know how many paid ads I get for B2B purposes on Instagram compared to actual B2C brands, right? It's just, they're very, very pervasive. And I think more and more B2B brands are beginning to realize we should stick some marketing dollars over here to get in front of that person when they're not in a work environment, right? They're not looking at work emails. They're not scrolling LinkedIn, but maybe they're just looking at some other feed and they're going to pour money in, and it will get more and more competitive. And if you're B2B, it's a tremendous opportunity for you. But if you're B2C, just be aware that it might start to get a little bit more competitive out there in terms of just the pervasiveness of ads. I don't know if you've seen that, Gordon, working with different clients or talking with different folks, but
definitely seen a huge growth in B2B marketing. In fact, obviously I'm a partner to the B2B Marketing Expo in London. So I did a talk all about this. And I think what I would say though, is that, you know, a B2B influencer may not see himself as an influencer. He may be a person of influence. He may be a product matter expert. He might be an entrepreneur, you know, he might be a number of other things, but he has, or she has, a very engaged audience and a niche one at that. And, you know, influencer marketing doesn't have to be around just the three channels that we talked about today.
Yeah.
It can also be around LinkedIn and Twitter, perhaps even more so LinkedIn. And that could be around, you know, creating thought leadership reports. It could be about co-created content on a podcast. It could be around, you know, working with an influencer to create some training or a bespoke workshop to an audience that you, but I've just secured a job for a big tech company to sponsor my podcast, actually. But that's because they want access to my community.
Yeah.
And, you know, so it's definitely a place for this to happen more and more.
Yeah, I think definitely thinking outside of the scope of the medium, right? An influencer that has a really, really popular blog, right? I think about like the AWS guy has a really, really popular blog. He's on social media as well. And so you can use tools like ours to find, right, these sort of thought leaders. But the chief value of the investment that you have with them might be showing up on some other format, right? Podcasts, in a blog article, doing some sort of long form content on YouTube that you weren't thinking would be, you know, it's not influencer marketing as you typically think about it, but it's the same idea. You're getting in front of the addressable audience in an engaging way.
Exactly.
Awesome. So we ran through that, Gordon. I'll let you take a breath and a sip. I'm gonna go ahead and let folks know we are opening it up for an open Q&A for Gordon. I'll chime in as well if I feel like I have anything to add, but I'm sure Gordon brings a lot more valuable perspective than I do. The first question that we had during the webinar that I want to address from Giuliano was, do you guys think we should start using an audience engaged statistic, right? So instead of a person that has 100,000 followers, right? If only 1% of them are engaged, we'd be thinking about that as, well, I'm reaching 1,000 people here. And maybe this influencer with 40,000 followers actually has 10,000 that are engaged. And so their engaged audience is much, much bigger, even though their total audience is smaller. I think it's a little bit of a leading, I'm teeing it up in a leading way, Gordon, but what are your thoughts there?
I mentioned it, and this is the reason why I often say to people, work with experts like yourselves and others that have, you know, it's all about the data. It's all about the relevance of the audience. You know, if you want a beauty influencer to work with you, you want to make sure that the people that are following that person have a high percentage of interest in beauty, you know, and not just, you know, guys with tongue hanging out, which is a completely wasted audience. In the same way that I would say that, you know, if you were a restaurant owner, you wanted to have a new restaurant opening in London, then you'll want to have an influencer that's got a high percentage of London-based followers, because otherwise the likely conversion rate on the engagement is going to be small. If half that audience is based in the Philippines or in, you know, South America, wasted. So I agree with the point that's been made that we shouldn't get het up on the sheer size of the audience, but the relevance and the engagement of it, for me, will always be the most important.
Yeah, I think that angle, my initial thought, Giuliano, to your question was, yeah, we want to think about authentic audience too, people that have been tuning in and still actively engaging. But your angle, Gordon, of also taking that sort of authenticity, engagement spin on it, but actually slicing it down to, well, where are they? What percentage of them are the ones that you care about? And I'm happy to say, like, we have a tool that allows you to do that. Hey, if you want a certain propensity of folks in this area, you can find creators where most of their folks, you know, we could draw the percentages you want, are in this London area where they could be more addressable. And then I think that ultimately what it means for you as the marketer is you go to the creator when you're having that conversation, and you have to be very transparent, say, like, the most important thing to me is this subset, right? I get that you've got a million followers, or if they got a million followers, it's going to be hard to get off of that. But maybe if they've got 10 or 15,000 or they got 50,000, I get that you got 50,000. I really just care about these 12,000 or these 8,000. Those are the ones that I want to reach. This is where I'm going to see value. So how can we create content for this? How can we even come to an agreement price-wise, knowing that, right? But it's going to take some transparency in terms of your goals and what you're looking for. And then also a tool, right? Like a tool like HypeAuditor, where you can show them, hey, here's an independent third party using publicly available data that says, this is your addressable audience here, and this is who I want. What can we do to make a deal, right? If they're bigger, it's going to be hard to fight that battle. But I think, Giuliano, you're spot on. You want to avoid the big number of followers and really be thinking about authentic, addressable, aligned audience to get the most out of your money. And then I think you'll also be able to probably negotiate some of those rates down.
Particularly if you've got the data supporting it, like you just said.
Yeah. And it's great. Again, shamelessly, a tool like ours, you could say, I've got this third party report, right? An influencer is always going to, or creator is always going to say, well, here's what Instagram says, but Instagram's not necessarily filtering out inauthentic engagement like our tool is. So you could say, yeah, you've got 4,000 comments, but they were all nice pick. It's not valuable to me. I want something that's actually valuable to what we're doing. And so being able to have that data is really, really important. From Dot Gay, we've got, any thoughts on Reels versus TikTok videos? What do you think, Gordon?
I think Reels are the way to go all day long.
Okay.
They're the ones that are driving the greatest level of growth. I think Reels are a better form than TikTok videos, but that's my view.
Yeah, the only piece that I would add to that is, in those conversations, why not say, like, this is where we want to be, right, from an engagement perspective, but we'd love to also be on that channel with you, influencer. Like, you're creating content. We want to be in both places. Both is better than one, in my perspective as a marketer. I think that's great perspective, Gordon, on Reels. We got to vote for Reels. Linda Bravo, based on your experience and data, which channel would be best to outreach baby boomers and Generation X, 40 plus folks?
Baby boomers. I don't know if she's heard of Mum's Net, but that's a huge community. Is this lady American or UK? Don't know.
Her name is Linda Bravo. I would say could be either.
Yeah. The only reason I say that, because Mum's Net is a great, great community. And I know that they do quite a lot of activity on Instagram and Facebook. I would suggest, we haven't really talked about Facebook here, but there are lots of, you know, mums love communities generally, and they like, so being able to work with mummy bloggers or Facebook groups, you know, is the way to go, in my opinion.
Yeah, I think, to me, that also drills down to finding a tool, right, like HypeAuditor allows you to look for creators that have an audience that tends to be a little bit older, right, or whatever that target age range, gender breakdown is that you're looking for with the products that you sell, and sort of whatever channel where those folks are is where you want to meet them, right? If they're engaging on Instagram, then that's fine, right? But don't blindly partner with somebody on Instagram without knowing, hey, this is what the data suggests. There's lots of people there.
Yeah. Well, that's a wider subject, isn't it? Going where your audience is, not where you think they are.
Yeah. And having the data to feel confident in that. We know where they are, right? Mm. And some of that, even you could just ask questions, right? Ask people around you. Where do you hang out, essentially? What's the best way to track influencer marketing campaigns, our INF campaigns, influencer campaigns? I've got a thought, but Gordon, how do you think
your tool is one of them?
yeah. Anything that can help automate it, right? Like HypeAuditor, again, very shamelessly, can automatically track all of those likes and comments and those statistics and aggregate them together into these campaigns. And if you want to group them by the influencer themselves or as a whole, and then I mentioned it with YouTube and their Shopify integration, but right, tools like ours that have an integration with a shopping cart. So you can also track those sales, direct response rate. Hey, has the creator gotten the product from me yet? I want to know where we stand with that. Are we negotiating, like managing that whole process? You could do it manually to start. If you're just choosing one, you're just getting started, but there's certainly tools out there, but you do need to pick your goals. Are you thinking about this from an engagement perspective? Or are you thinking about direct response? Are you thinking about it both? And then just making sure that you choose something that gives you that visibility. Because once it starts, right, and if you don't have visibility, then you don't have visibility. Maybe you could look in Google Analytics to see if the sales go up, but that's not super useful after the fact.
Yeah, I would just say that if you're not using a tool and you want to work with some influencers, you know, ask for their media kit to start with, so you get a good idea of what they have done in previous campaigns and their sort of results, because that's a good start point. And then once you've worked with them afterwards, then you know they'll share with you their analytics. So you can actually understand exactly, because let's not forget, the influencer wants a campaign to work. It's not just about, the ones that are half decent anyway, they want it to work. So, because actually if it fails, it fails for the brand, it fails for the influencer and the audience. So everybody's got a vested interest in making this work. And one thing I would say is if you are working with influencers for this first time, please, 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 start right at the outset of the campaign objective. So you're almost collaborating on what it is you're trying to achieve. I think sometimes campaigns do not work when they just use influencers as a last minute amplifier. So they've already got the campaign, we'll just use a number of influencers to give it that last push. And yet, you know, these are creative people, you know, make the use of but the best of them.
Yeah, definitely. You want them to feel like they're able to speak in their voice, and this is really, really aligned with what they like to do. And you're leveraging their creativity, telling an influencer what to do, how to do it on a product that they aren't very aligned with. I can share a horror story if you ever want to hear one. It does not work. I hate to say it, but your product's not that great where it can overcome that misalignment. It's just a great way to spend a lot of money for nothing. We have a great question from Fernanda. She works for a global toy company starting to grow brands in Latin America. How does she think about highlights are there highlights that we have for the Latin America influencer market? Are they more engaged? How do you get people to buy online? Because it is a little bit more different, or it's a little bit different culturally in terms of behavior. I do know we will have a report for Latin America markets that we usually put that out that breaks it down for that segment specifically. But in my mind, if your product is just an online only product, you want to make sure that you eliminate those hurdles, right? It can't be too expensive. Can't be too expensive to ship. It's got to show up in a timely manner. If all of that stuff feels good, then it's just about finding the right buyer, right? If you're aligned on who the person is and who would buy our product, they'll purchase the product. Now, if the product's too expensive and it costs $100 to ship and it will take 6 weeks to get there, it's not a market problem or a cultural challenge. It's too inconvenient. So making sure that you're crossing through those. But I think we'll have more statistics there. I don't know, Gordon, do you have any thoughts specifically around the Latin American market?
I have an interest in Brazil, particularly having been there last year. And also in your stats, if you remember right at the beginning, it made reference to Brazil being second in that area. Well, I also know that Brazil has the highest conversion rate of consumers to influencers than anywhere else in the world. So particularly on YouTube. So there is a real, they love their influencers. I think largely because there are less of them. So because there is less of them, those that are significant have got huge audiences, and therefore they are seen as celebrities in those countries as well. So you can, and also it's more cost effective. So the same YouTuber in South America, even with a similar audience, would be less money probably than an American equivalent.
And I do think you'll get the benefit too. Just I was talking about this in a webinar a couple of weeks ago. That regional value of if you're based in this country and you're talking to people in that country with an influencer that's from that country, you're going to see value in terms of performance. Try to avoid like, oh, I've got this person that's in a different market. Maybe I can get them to speak. Don't do it. Like, there's really, really good alignment there. And so then it's just more about the operations, right? If Fernanda, if you're looking at your site and your checkout process and all that, you're like, it's just really, really clunky. It doesn't matter what channel you use, like that's going to be a hindrance. And so you need to resolve those things before you can make a judgment over like, oh, how will this work? But we've heard it from Gordon. I know that we have lots of partner customers as well, where they see a lot of direct response success there. So I think it's just about navigating that. From Giuliano again. What are some ways to incorporate traditional marketing research like Simmons and Ryan Statistic or Statista into influencer marketing? I think you were talking about this, Gordon, right? These folks are doing studies as well. You can
They
find
are.
their data. If you do secretly, I would do a Google image search because sometimes you can get a chart that's unlocked. But yeah, you can find it out there for sure. The data is there and use it to shape what you're how you treat the market that you're going into.
That's a good point. One thing I was also going to say, and I do have data because I'm involved in the Branded Content Marketing Association. I have data from all sorts of different sources. And one of the people on the BCMA Council, Professor Jonathan Hardy, is setting up a global research center for branded content and influencer marketing. So if that data exists, there's a good chance that I'll know where to get it or be able to point people. So if you guys are interested in specific market analysis, then we might be able to help. And one thing I was going to say about research, though, is it's one of the big benefits of using influencer marketing. We've talked a lot about, selling, we've talked about brand awareness, but one should never underestimate the power of research and using this amazing, highly engaged audiences to get a flavor for what the brands of tomorrow are going to be. That's why Nike have invested in all sorts of different technologies to almost prod and poke, would this work well? Do you guys like this? Now you're starting to talk about having your own personalized shoe. Now that's come about because of influencer marketing and being able to tap, you look at the TV, for example. You can't, the advertiser can't ask the TV person at home what do they think of that product or presentation, but you can with an influencer.
All right, so Mackenzie asked, do you have any tips for keeping relationships with influencers? Gordon, I'll hand it to you first. I know I've got some thoughts on that as well.
Yeah, I do. Something I feel quite strongly about is do not, under any circumstances, send the same email to hundreds and hundreds of influencers. It just makes it feel like they're not special. You haven't bothered to recognize them. They've created this amazing community and audience, and you're treating them like you would just a blanket email, and the worst ones are ones that say, "Dear influencer." You're going to get zero response from those people. Already 70% of emails are not responded to by influencers. So for me, it's absolutely about crafting a relationship. I use this process called jab, jab, punch, which means like, comment, politely ask. and then use a really nice crafted message that recognizes the content that they have created, and how it synergizes with your product or service. You're more likely to get a response then. It's the equivalent of, you know, you wouldn't go into a conference, would you, and then just thrust your business card in front of somebody and say, look, should we start doing business together? No, you would start to, you know, start to try and build a relationship up. So why would you not do the same online?
Yeah, and I think if you're thinking about, I've got this active network or bench of influencers, I just need to keep them engaged. Regular messaging can do some of the trick, but I think even it can boil down to the relationship itself. If you've been working with a creator for a while and they do a tremendous job, it's producing a good return regularly. They're really nice. You just like working with them. If you can shift that model to almost a little bit of a performance-based rev share where they might end up getting more money at the end of the day, but you get along well, they're very aligned, it's going to bring that relationship closer because you're going to want to work closer together to be successful. And so that's just one way that I would suggest for making the commercials piece of it sort of conducive to, like, let's talk and work together more. Because even similar to what you're saying, Gordon, right, you could have a great relationship with somebody, but if your only interactions are with them, hey, I want you to do this, how much does it cost, right? Like, eventually that it's very, very impersonal feeling. So if there is something there, try to keep the communication regular. It's not just about campaigns, and it's asking them for ideas and how exactly. You can sort of make them more invested in the process. And the easiest way to make them more invested is say, what if we shift to, I'll pay you this flat amount and I'll give you 10% of whatever, or 15% of whatever. Maybe it's a little bit better than the affiliate offer that you have running. They'll see that as a true investment in them. And then they end up working much, much harder because their growth potential becomes unlimited, not, well, I'll do a story for X and a post for Y. And so I think that that's a really valuable way to think about the commercials and how they can ultimately impact that relationship.
Just to add to that super quick, is that good influencers know other influencers. So if you treat them well, look after them, and you want to work with two or three others, there's a good chance that they know some other influencers as well that you could, and that's that they're only going to share that with you if they've had a good experience with you and good relationship.
Trisha Lynn, I think this is a great observation. Something to keep in mind, right? It's a shaky bet on TikTok when there's so much regulatory stuff happening. I think it's something that you do have to keep in mind. And to Gordon, your point earlier, you don't want to bet the farm on a network that, you know, is being taken off of state level devices all the time. Like you just don't know. And so I think you have to balance that investment and then work with the creators. Like, you can vocalize your concern. Hey, can we make sure that we're on multiple networks as well? Because, you know, we're just a little bit concerned here going all in with this. And it might just be that certain creators that are only on TikTok, although that's becoming fewer and fewer, they do tend to spread out. It might just not be a good fit. It might just be too much, right? Or just really think about the terms of that commercial relationship. Just keep on scrolling through the questions as we near the end. Someone asked if they could hear my horror story. I'll just say that if you're going to go live with a product and you're like, I've got perfect influencers, we're going to spend all of this money, there's no way we can't not get a bunch of sales. Yes, you can. It probably will happen. Don't do it. It can be very, very expensive. And especially if you don't find the right alignment with influencers. And one of the first things I did actually when I joined HypeAuditor was then I looked at the authenticity of the creators. And I was like, this would have been so easy to spot. Like, this was not going to go well. But we just sort of, you know, took things as sort of they were stated and just ran with it. So definitely be thinking about who's the audience you want to work with. What is the engagement? What's the authenticity? Are they aligned with what we're trying to do? Is this a product launch where we don't know anything about conversions? Probably best not to do a grand opening type format. It's better to actually test things out. So that's all I'm going to...
100% is A and B testing. Really important that because even though the creator may know your product, it's not a guarantee that it's new to his or her audience. So, you know, when you see a film, for example, think about content as a film. We don't just suddenly see a film. It's trailed, it's teased, it's created a suspense. So, you know, those are all important things. You know, we take as consumers a number of touch points before we convert, because we want to feel trusted and know that our needs are being met. And that isn't going to come always from one post.
Yeah, definitely. All right. So there's two more questions I'm going to, or one more question I'm going to answer. I'm going to drop my email in the chat. And if you have any other questions, if there are questions for Gordon, just let me know and I can forward them along to him. So the last question I'll go through is, how would you, LNS, how would you go and see the results of gifted collaborations with influencers rather than paid ones? Gifted collaborations work really, really well if the influencer loves your product.
Yeah.
If the influencer doesn't know who you are, they probably have a closet full of stuff that is just sent to them all the time. And very rarely do they, and this is no offense to products, but very rarely is your product so unique and aligned that they go, I'm just now going to talk about this to everyone. Because like, how many products in your real life do you have that you go, I got this and I'm just telling everybody? And so it's really, if you can, right, we have a great tool that does this, right? If you can say, oh, I've got creators that are already buying from me, I want to show them my new product, right? I want to upload their email list, the Hype Auditor, match them, reach out to them personally and say like, hey, I know that you bought from us before. I think you would love this new thing that we're coming out with. They probably will be very receptive to a gifting campaign like that. They might still want a little bit of an investment depending on the size of their audience. But I think you'll find it's much easier to do a paid arrangement unless there's really, really good alignment. And then they tend to be pretty open to something gift related. Just manage the size. I don't know, Gord, if you have any thoughts on like the average size, but I know that if you went up to somebody with 100,000 followers and said, I'll give you this, I'm trying to find something on my desk. I cleaned it. That's a good example. Like, I'll give you this notebook. Isn't it so cool? I don't think you're really going to resonate with them. If it's
zero.
Maybe with 2,000 followers and they do a lot of writing and you see them post content about notebooks, maybe, but it is really going to matter with the alignment there. And a lump sum, as it were, is the easiest way to sort of like break through that concern that they might have.
So the two things that matter for a content creator are, one, being paid. And, you know, I have no problem whatsoever in influencers being paid for the work that they have created, the content that they have created. You wouldn't go and speak to a magazine and say, is it all right if I have an ad for free? Is it all right if I have an ad on the magazine, the TV for free? No, because, and they've got audiences. So the second thing that's most important to an influencer is nourishing and growing their audience. So if you don't have money, but you do want to get that product in front of an influencer, assume the tables are turned. You know, think about their challenges and their issues and putting yourself in their eyes. And actually, you know, I would always try, and before a gifting is sending a direct message or an email, trying to build that relationship and say, look, we would like to send you something. Just wanted to be checking if you're receptive to receiving something, because in a way, otherwise you could be wasting. Absolutely. I've seen influencer homes and they've just got piles of these gifts not going anywhere, which is, and I'm sure you know exactly what I mean. It's better to send a few of them out to the right people that you know are going to do something with, than thinking, right, well, I've sent 100 of these gifts out. It's a bit of a hope and pray. But even if you had a modest budget, there's a higher chance of getting it done with, you know, maybe it's $100 or something, very small. It's a token gesture that says we value the work that you have done and the audience that you've created. That's all it really is.
Yeah, definitely. Well, great. So we have two brief slides for, there's about 48 folks that have still stuck around. Please email me with any questions. George, I see your question. Please just email me directly. I'm happy to connect with you, share a little more about our platform. The goal of this isn't to be a commercial, so I won't dive into that too much. I did want to share We'll be sending out, I'll talk with Nick on our team. The plan is to send this the report itself out where we pulled a lot of this data. There's more visuals and insights and information in the report itself. So we'll be sending this global report out. We do have, I'd say, half a dozen, maybe a little bit more regional-based reports, international regions too. We're actually a very global company. I think maybe 80% of our team is on the other side of the globe. So we definitely understand a lot of our clients are on different parts of the world. So we create these reports for different regions using the same sort of source of data that we're able to compile, but then segmenting it per region. So if you're thinking I'm in Europe, I wonder if they have my country. I think we probably do. So just definitely reach out. And then the last thing that I have, and then Gordon, I'll let you sort of give us the farewell, is that we will be hosting a webinar in a couple of weeks. We'll send it along with the email. What metrics matter when choosing an influencer? And spoilers, it's not just engagement rate. If you think it's just engagement rate and you don't have to attend, it's not just that. And so we'll dive into how you choose the right influencer in a couple of weeks. I think it will be the 10th of February, that Thursday, around 2 p.m. Eastern again. So look for more information on that. And with that, Gordon, I really appreciate the marathon that you ran with me today, an hour and 20 minutes. I really appreciate everybody's questions. Gordon, any insights or perspective or sort of takeaways, even if you said them once before, that you would share with the group when they go on, like the thing that they really need to remember as they're applying this information?
Well, all I would say is the information that you've shared today has been fantastic, Ryan, and it proves the value of insights. Insights help us make decisions. Whether or not you're a marketer or whether or not you are within, one of the biggest challenges often is sharing the value of what influencer marketing can bring to a company. It's not always a silver bullet, but it is absolutely the new medium of creating awareness and conversion through performance marketing. If you've not done influencer marketing before, really think about starting small, test it, measure it. That's absolutely essential. Use the tools of companies like HypeAuditor or others that are out there. It does make a big, big difference in you getting the results that you want.
Yeah, and with that, I again appreciate it, Gordon. I appreciate everybody for joining us, staying a little bit late. Thank you for vocalizing all of your questions. Again, reach out if you have any from us. Look for a follow-up email, but we really appreciate everybody's time, and we'll see you soon.